Well, hello there, and welcome to Hudson First United Methodist Church online worship service this morning. Good morning to you all. Grace and peace be unto you in the name of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. My name is Pastor Brian Comiskey, and I'm leading us in worship service today. I welcome you all. God bless you. I pray that you're having the most blessed day. I hope your week was very good. I pray that it was full of blessings, and I pray that the next week will be full of blessings as well. And so let's get to worshiping. And the only thing I really have to say for announcements is I mentioned it last week. This week also, I thought I'd bring it up. We have a new link to it to, if you want to do a tithe or offering, that's available for you through a PayPal link that we have in the description below. I'll touch on that in a little while. So anyway, let's get to our worship this morning. We're here to worship the Lord, and let's do so together. Our call to worship this morning. We come with praise for the wonderful work of God. Even before we speak, God knows us completely. The Holy One knows us and sustains us, even in our moments of confusion and doubt. Who can count the thoughts of God? They are more than all the sands of the desert. Like clay in the hands of the potter, we are shaped into vessels of divine will. We come with praise for the wonderful works of God. Praise be to the Almighty for sure, and we give thanks and praise to the Lord today with our worship. We're going to be doing some singing. We're going to do some prayer time. We'll have a message. We'll have some scripture. But speaking of singing, shall we go to our opening hymn this morning? And it is, This is the Day, and Alleluia, Our God Reigns. So it's a little medley for you this morning. Let's sing along. The words will be up on the screen.
We will rejoice and be glad.
Will you pray with me? Heavenly Father, you are beyond our knowing, yet closer to us than our very breath. You are before us and behind us, surrounding us with your love and fashioning all of creation in the secret depths of your heart. With every thought, with every song, with every prayer, turn us, O Lord, these fragile earthen vessels of ours, which we call our lives, into God's strengthened, spirit-filled body of Christ. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. Absolutely amen. And so let's get right over to our first scripture reading this morning, shall we? We'll pull it up here. It is Jeremiah 18, verses 1 through 11. This is the word that came to Jeremiah from the Lord. Go down to the potter's house, and there I will give you my message. So I went down to the potter's house, and I saw him working at the wheel. But the pot he was shaping from the clay was marred in his hands. So the potter formed it into another pot, shaping it as seemed best to him. Then the word of the Lord came to me. He said, can I not do with you, Israel, as this potter does? Declares the Lord. Like clay in the hands of the potter, so are you in my hand, Israel. If at any time I announce that a nation or kingdom is to be uprooted, torn down, and destroyed, and if that nation I warned repents of its evil, then I will relent and not inflict on it the disaster I had planned. And if at another time I announce that a nation or kingdom is to be built up and planted, and if it does evil in my sight and does not obey me, then I will reconsider the good I had intended to do for it. Now therefore, say to the people of Judah and those living in Jerusalem, this is what the Lord says. Look, I am preparing a disaster for you and devising a plan against you. So turn from your evil ways, each one of you, and reform your ways and your actions. Here ends our first reading. May the Lord add his blessing to the reading and the hearing of his word this morning. Amen. Amen. Well, at this time, let's go to the Lord in prayer, shall we? We take this time to pray together. What a blessing it is to be able to pray with each other in this way, even though we're not in the same room, although we're not maybe doing this in this earthly time, meaning that we're not maybe praying at the same time in an earthly time way, I guess. What I'm trying to say is, even though we're watching this at different times, we are still praying together because there is no time and space really as we know it in heaven. So, in the Lord's kingdom. So let's go to the Lord in prayer. We lift up those who are having trouble and difficulties with their health. We pray for those who are hurting from losing a loved one in their life. We pray for those who are healing from maybe COVID. There's a couple of people that we've heard, at least in our area, that are getting over COVID. So we also give thanks for that. They are healing and their body is fighting it just fine. And then we pray for those who are needing food, those who are needing help with travel, those who are needing help with car repairs. We pray for them as well. We pray for those who are needing a shelter, a place to live. Maybe they're having trouble finding that, a place to live, and sometimes it can be difficult. We all go through that time at one point where things aren't going so well. So we pray for those who are needing help in different ways, in those ways. We pray for those people who are feeling lost in the spirit. They don't know, they're lost in feeling desperate maybe, feeling that they need something in their lives. They are unfulfilled, and we know that it's the Lord that they need. So we pray that they may find the Lord, that they may somehow be turned toward him, that they may be able to understand and learn those blessings that we as Christians, and I know we're not all perfect or anything, I'm just saying that at least we have the knowledge that we have the Lord, and we can rest on him, we can put our strength, rely with our by his strength anyway. So we pray for those who are needing the Lord, and so let's go to the Lord in prayer this morning. Lord, we lift up all of our joys, Lord, as well as our concerns. We pray for those who are needing that help, needing you in their lives. They need that blessing which you are, Lord, the blessings that you bestow and you give to us, that knowledge that we don't have to rely on ourselves. We don't have to rely on our own strength. We don't have to rely on our own lives. It is by your strength, Lord, that we are able to get through the best of times and the worst of times, whatever is going on in our lives, Lord. We put our trust in you, Lord. So we pray for those who are needing you, that they may be turned toward you, that they may somehow discover that joy which you are, that you provide that peace that is beyond understanding. Lord, we give thanks for all the blessings that we have, the blessings of clean water and shelter and food. We give you thanks for transportation. We pray that you may help us to see the blessings wherever we go. I mean, they are boundless. And Lord, help us to remember these things. We pray for those who are in our thoughts today who are needing healing and health. Lord, we pray for those who are desperate, trying to find food, shelter, car repairs, like we mentioned. Lord, we lift up those people that are having trouble right now. Lord, we give thanks that you are the greatest healer that ever was and ever is, ever shall be, Lord. You are wholeness itself. So we turn to you for our supplications, Lord, that we may turn to you in all that we need. And we pray that you may continue to lift us up in this way. Lord, we pray for those who are feeling lost in their minds. In other words, Lord, we pray for those who are having some mental health issues. It's such a lost feeling. Lord, personally, I just attended somebody or went to visit somebody who was in a place for Alzheimer's. And Lord, just want to pray for those people that once had a full life and were able to think for themselves, and they just are lost. And they don't know where they are and who they are. And it's just, Lord, I pray somehow we may find the cure for that. Lord, we are broken vessels. You've watched us, you've called to us, you've blessed us, and yet we have chosen our own flawed ways many times. Help us to amend that, Lord. Throughout the ages, you have sent your prophets to help us return to you. Some people heeded your call and turned again to lives of love and to witness, but others chose not to listen. Please, Lord, help us to tune our ears and our hearts to you. Help us to seek peace and justice rather than greed and complacency. As we have gathered here this morning to hear your word and to meditate upon your word, to sing praises to you, to offer our prayers, help us to remember that you hold us dearly in your hands. You cherish our lives and listen to our cries for help. You respond to our needs. Enable us to place our trust in you 100% totally, Lord, that we may faithfully serve you all the days of our lives. Lord, we pray for our church. We pray for all of our churches. We pray for our church families, for those who come and participate in our events. Lord, even if they aren't members, we give you thanks. We pray for all the churches of our communities, our schools. We pray for our children as they are just beginning to start school over these past couple weeks and the weeks to come. We pray that you may protect our children. We pray for our government, that we may be united, if nothing else, in you, Lord, and your love and your wisdom. We pray for our country. We pray for our world, that we may live in peace the way you intended. Lord, we give you thanks as we pray the prayer you taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Amen. Thank you. Thank you so much for praying with me today. And I give you thanks for continuing to sign into these services that we may pray together. Sometimes I feel like I go off a lot, but you know, it's important for us to pray together. It's important to take that time. And so I'm just so thankful that you joined me in that. It really is awesome. I think it means a lot. And I think it's wonderful for our lives and for our communities, and that we are able to get together at least in this way and pray together. Anyway, well, let's move on to our second scripture reading, shall we? Here we go. I'm going to pull it up here on the screen for you. Oh, call the prayer. Yep. I do this every week. I mean to have a moment of call the prayer music as we meditate upon the music and prepare our hearts for prayer. However, maybe we can just play this music while I do the next scripture reading. It's Luke 14, 25 through 33. Large crowds were traveling with Jesus. And turning to them, he said, "If anyone comes to me and does not hate father and mother, wife and children, brothers and sisters, yes, even their own life, such a person cannot be my disciple. And whoever does not carry their cross and follow me cannot be my disciple. Suppose one of you wants to build a tower. Won't you first sit down and estimate the cost to see if you have enough money to complete it? For if you lay the foundation and are not able to finish it, everyone who sees it will ridicule you, saying, 'This person began to build and wasn't able to finish.' Or suppose a king is about to go to war against another king. Won't he first sit down and consider whether he is able with 10,000 men to oppose the one coming against him with 20,000? If he is not able, he will send a delegation while the other is still a long way off and will ask for terms of peace. In the same way, those of you who do not give up everything you have cannot be my disciples." This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. Well, you know, I was thinking about this a little bit in our scripture today. The Lord did talk about building a tower. And it made me start to think about some of the taller edifices that we know today. For instance, Big Ben in London, over in England there. Big Ben was completed in 1856. It was designed by architects Charles Barry and Augustus Welby Pugin. It took 13 years to build, which is a crazy long time considering they were working around the clock. Okay. Sorry, had to do it. Anyway, hope that came through okay. If not, I might have to watch out for those tomatoes being thrown at me. But anyway, I have to tell this story too. There were two friends. They loved bungee jumping. Do you remember bungee jumping? It was quite a craze. You don't see it as much anymore, but they were thinking about it. They said, "We love it so much, we should go into business for ourselves and open up a bungee jumping tower." And so what they did is they studied and decided they would open it up in Mexico. I mean, the regulations weren't so overbearingly strict there. The insurance was much lower. So they do it. They go there into Mexico and buy the property. They build the tower. And all the local people were gathered around every day to watch the progress. Well, finally, they finished it and they have to test it. So they draw straws to see who has to test it. And the one friend is chosen to do the testing. So he does it. He jumps and he bounces at the end of the cord. But when he comes back up, the second friend notices that he has a few cuts and scratches. Well, unfortunately, the friend isn't able to catch him, so he falls again and bounces and comes back up. This time, he's bruised and bleeding. But again, the friend misses him, and so the other friend falls and bounces back up again. This time, he comes back pretty messed up. He's got a couple of broken bones and is almost unconscious. But luckily, this time, his friend was able to catch him, and he pulls him in onto the platform. And he says, "What happened? Was the cord too long?" And he said, "No, the cord was fine. But what the heck is a piñata?" Anyway, okay. That's enough of that. Anyway. Oh, man. Oh, boy. Well, our scripture reading today, we find that the Lord is talking about the idea of building a tower. He talked about the cost of being a disciple. And so we read what Jesus said. And you know, it's a little startling, isn't it? He says, whoever comes to me and does not hate his father and mother, brothers and sister and wife, children, and yes, even their own life, cannot be my disciple. And once I wasted 20 minutes of my life debating with a relative of mine whether God can hate. And they said, well, God hates sin. And my retort was that any statement that had God hating anything is a false statement. I mean, God is love itself. God is truth itself. And if love can hate, then it's a house divided, and that cannot stand. But anyway, I'm not going to talk too much about this because it only takes a little bit of thinking, I believe, a little bit of discernment to realize that Jesus Christ, the Prince of Peace, the one who commanded us to love God, love our neighbors, love our enemies, who also answered when somebody asked him what they must do to gain eternal life, said, keep the commandments. And the man asked him, well, which ones? And Jesus replied, do not murder, do not commit adultery, do not steal, do not give false testimony, and honor your father and your mother, and love your neighbor as yourself. And we realize that Jesus Christ would never call us to hate anyone. The translation of hate from Greek is actually misio, which can mean to love less than. So what Jesus is telling us, if anybody puts anything, in this case, our family and ourselves, above Christ, they are not worthy to be a disciple. And it would make sense to use family or even ourselves, because family can be such a high priority in people's lives. But we are called to love Christ above all else. And Jesus is not calling us to do this because he wants glory for the sake of glory itself. The picture of Jesus sitting on a throne in the highest heavens and lording it all over the people as they serve him, that's the very thing that Jesus rejected when he rode into Jerusalem on Palm Sunday. But he knows, as disciples, to prioritize the Lord above all else is to prioritize divine love in our lives. We prioritize divine truth when we do this, which ultimately leads to our happiness. The Lord knows this. He wants us to be happy. And then Jesus said in the scripture, whoever does not carry their cross cannot follow me. So what is our cross? Our cross is what hinders us in our spiritual growth. It's the influence of hell trying to sway us, the enemy trying to lead us away from the Lord. A word that we can use is temptation. But not only the temptation we experience in our lives, it's when we give in to temptation, which we all do at some point, let's face it. And the after effects, the guilt, the feeling of unworthiness that comes to us when we do fall short, those are the tricks the enemy uses. And so Jesus, in this scripture, tells us, suppose you want to build a tower. And this tower, by the way, Jesus is talking about, is it a real tower made with man-made bricks? Well, if so, what would the tower be used for? Well, towers are used to be able to elevate somebody so they can look down on the land and see everything around them. You can see the big picture. You can spot an enemy coming and prepare for an attack. Or they can use a tower for crops to watch out for wild animals that might destroy the crops of their field and ward them off when they come. They can be used for watching for fires that might destroy. But when Jesus taught, he talked about things of the Spirit. And so he's talking about a spiritual tower. And what would a spiritual tower be? A spiritual tower means to build up within us truths and principles. As we live life and in the process of learning and growing spiritually, we go through conflicts and we realize that we need to find a way to get above our problems. We need to be able to look down upon them objectively. We need to be able to reflect and figure out how are we going to deal with these problems. And so we turn to the Lord, and through scripture and prayer and meditation, we are provided with certain truths. And these truths are like the bricks we use. We use these bricks to build a tower, and they help us to deal with these problems. So what are the truths that we might use? Well, everybody is different. Not all situations are the same, and we actually might not discover certain truths until we are attacked by the enemy. The enemy attacks us in a very cunning way. We may slip up and backslide. We sin, and the so-called power of hell will try to deceive us into believing that our relationship with the Lord is now damaged. The enemy will try and convince us that we are separated somehow from God, and that, well, maybe I'm not worthy of the love of God. Guilt overcomes us, and that voice may come to us. And we might hear, I don't deserve God's love. I don't deserve heaven. So that's why it's important that we build that spiritual tower, to be able to look from a higher perspective and to see those attacks from the enemy and be able to say, wait a minute. It says here in Psalm 139, where can I flee from your presence? If I go up to the heavens, you are there. If I make my bed in hell, you are there. In Romans chapter 8, it says, nothing can ever separate us from God's love, neither death nor life, neither angel nor demon, neither our fears for today nor our worries about tomorrow, not even the powers of hell can separate us from God's love. And so we build this tower. We build a stronghold with these truths, these scriptures, these spiritual bricks that we're given. Because life happens, and it's inevitable that we come to that place where we are tempted to doubt our God-given worth. And we get knocked down, and it's at those weakest points where the enemy prods us, you're nothing. You're worthless. We can start to believe that. And we can become spiritually lethargic, and we get into a rut, and things begin to get routine and boring, and we fall into this kind of despair. And we can start thinking, God has more important things to deal with someone like me. The Lord's too busy doing other things, more important things, and we start to believe the lies of hell. But the truth is, God would never leave us. The Lord is right here with us, and there are boundless blessings that surround us. Even though they're right before our eyes, we can miss them. But there is no day in the Lord's kingdom, really, that hasn't been put before us that holds a treasure trove of blessings. There really is no day that ever was that didn't hold endless miracles. There is no boring day in the Lord's kingdom. Today is the day that the Lord will provide for our best spiritual day. This is the day the Lord has made, Psalm 118. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. Those spiritual bricks, we build them up. And we use them as a stronghold. We use them to be able to look objectively over the situation. God didn't say, well, let's see. They've been too happy too many days in a row. I'm going to stick some boring days in there. That's my impression of God. That's sure what he sounds like. No, we can have restful days for sure, but when things get hard and we feel life is beginning to go downhill and despair starts to overwhelm us, we need to rise above the situation and look at it from a higher perspective and realize the enemy is doing this. Matthew 13, the enemy is planting tares among the wheat, creating doubt, creating fear. There's another spiritual brick. But when we have a solid foundation to stand on and look at it from a higher ground, we can prepare ourselves with these truths, right? And so in scripture, Jesus said, who doesn't sit down before building a tower and count the cost? And what is the cost? Well, first of all, I think we have to be all in. We need to ask ourselves, do I want to build a tower? Do I want to have a defense against attacks from the enemy? And the answer is hopefully yes. Do we want to stay down in the muck and the mire? Do we want to wallow in our own self-pity? And sadly, you know, I'm afraid the answer is too often yes. Why? Because it's easy to be down there. It's comfortable down there. I'm guilty of it. It's too hard. But that's why we build that edifice, so we have the strength to overcome it. And by the way, we don't build it by our own strength. And that's the point. It's strength from God's word. It's the solid understanding we gain of who we are and whose we are. It's the solid rock we stand on. And we do that by prioritizing the Lord. We put the Lord at the center of our lives. Yes, even over our family. Yes, even over ourselves. It's the cost. But here's some trivia for you. I want to mention this really quick. So I just recently found this out. What is the shortest chapter in the Bible? We're talking chapters here, not books. And it turns out that Psalm 117 is the shortest. It has like two sentences. And the next question is, what is the longest chapter in the Bible? Two chapters later, Psalm 119 is the longest chapter in the Bible. It's long. Okay, so what is chapters the very center of the Bible? I quoted it earlier, Psalm 118. Right in the middle of those two I just mentioned. And so there's 594 chapters before Psalm 118, and there's 594 chapters after Psalm 118. And if you add up these two numbers, 594 plus 594, you get 1,188. Or 1188. And so what is the center verse in the Bible? Psalm 118, verse 8. That's the very center verse in the Bible. Does this verse say something significant about God's perfect will for our lives? Well, the next time somebody says they would like to find God's perfect will for their lives and they want to be in the center of his will, just send them to the center of his word. Psalm 118, 8. Says it's better to trust in the Lord than to put confidence in man. Is it a coincidence how this worked out? Or was God at the center of it? So when things get tough, always remember, faith doesn't get you around trouble, it gets you through it. Jesus once asked his disciples, "Who do you say I am?" And the disciple Peter said, "You are the Messiah, the Son of the living God." And Jesus replied, "Blessed are you, Simon, son of Jonah. This was not revealed to you by flesh and blood, but by my Father in heaven." And he also said, "You are Peter, and on this rock I will build my church, and Hades will not overcome it." The rock Jesus is referring to is not Peter himself as a man. It's not one man. It's what he said. Jesus is the Christ. And this rock, this truth, is the foundation of our faith. So our faith doesn't help us around trouble. It gets us through it because we have that solid foundation. We have built that spiritual tower, and our fortress is founded in Christ. 1 Corinthians chapter 5 says, "For we know that if the tent that is our earthly home is destroyed, we have been building from God, a house not made with hands, eternal in the heavens." Amen. Well, if you'd like to join me in our closing hymn as we close it out here, I would be most grateful. Let's sing this together, shall we? We're going to go over to, oh, there it is, Building a Spiritual Tower. That's the message. Anyway, let's go to our closing hymn today. "They Will Know We Are Christians by Our Love."
We are one in the Spirit, we are one in the Lord. We are one in the Spirit, we are one in the Lord. And we pray that our unity may one day be restored. And they'll know we are Christians by our love. Yes, they'll know we are Christians by our love. yes, they'll know we are Christians by our love.
I just want to give you thanks for joining me once again for our online service here at Hudson First United Methodist Church. I did want to mention really quick, I was talking before about our new online giving. I want to thank everybody who have been so kind in giving their tithes and offerings toward us using our online service. It means a lot, and I really appreciate it. Just thank you so much for that. And if you are interested in giving to our online service, I'm just going to quickly put this over here so you can see. Let me take this weird mug off the screen. There we go. And anyway, so you can see here. Wait, let me. One second. I want to be able to show you the cursor. There it is. So down here at the bottom, you'll see the description. And there you go. Right here in the description. Sometimes over here, it won't show the whole description. You'll see more. You got to press more. And then down here is the screen, the link rather, and you hit the link. And so you'll have an option to, well, if it ever comes up here, there it goes. You put in an amount, we'll just say $100. And you can, if you have a PayPal account, you can use that using this button, but I'm sure most people will use this debit credit card button. You click that, and then you just put in, you have an option to make it a monthly donation, and then you put in your information. PayPal is very secure. It has a good reputation for security. So, and there you go. You put it in, you put in your all your information, donate now, and it's as simple as that. So I just wanted to share that with you, and thank you so much for all you, once again, who have been kind enough to give to our church. So thank you again very, very much. Anyway, so therefore, my beloved brothers and sisters, be steadfast, be immovable, always abounding in the work of the Lord, knowing that in the Lord your labor is not in vain. Happy Labor Day, by the way, to everybody. Go now in peace to love and serve the Lord. Amen. Amen. Take care. Have a wonderful day. Have a wonderful week to come. God bless you all, and we'll see you soon. Bye.